to Agape Community Fellowship. We welcome you this morning to come in and praise with us. We welcome you to come and rejoice in the Lord with us.
Amen.
We welcome you whether you're here in person or if you're virtual. You are welcome, you're welcome, you're welcome. Father God, we just come before you this morning, oh God, and we lift up the name that is above all names. We thank you in the name of Jesus for being who you are, oh God. We thank you, Father God, for what you did let happen. We bless you in the name of Jesus for the blessings, oh God. Those that we see, those that are coming, oh God, and those that are promised. Father God, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Come on, saints, we done made it a whole week. Give the Lord some praise this morning. Bless his name this morning. In the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you and we thank you. In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. Are we glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Thank you, Lord.
We're just glad to be alive this morning. Glad to be in your right mind. Hallelujah.
We thank you.
Hallelujah. Come on and praise the Lord this morning like you got some gladness in you.
All right.
Hallelujah.
All right.
Thank you. Put your hands together.
You call somebody out?
Hallelujah.
Hear the chains falling. and he's going down. In the name of Jesus. Pray a little bit.
So come and bow. bow down this morning. Come on and bow down this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just like we heard in the spirit that those chains were falling off. Woo! You got to come on and bow before the Lord this morning and know that because you came to him, because you laid everything at his feet, that he took those chains and he broke them. Hallelujah. He didn't break them, he destroyed them. Because when you destroy it, it can't be fixed. Hallelujah. It can't be restored if you destroy it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Binding up everything that tried to hold us down, Father. We thank you that you're turning the tables, Lord, in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Father God, that you've given us the upper hand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you for showing us, Father God, how we're going to get through. Thank you for making a way, Father God, when we were surrounded, we're clearing the path, Father God, so that we can get through. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Oh, he's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Up in the house this morning. Let me tell you something. The Spirit of the Lord is here this morning. It's like y'all came to the doorway and refused to step in. Somebody better go ahead and cross that line. It's the line you want to cross. Hallelujah. This is the time that you give the Lord your show on praise. Because whatever you got down in you, you better give them all. The Lord is seeking it right now. God, we thank you. We thank you.
Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
Without you,
and I
Lord, let your presence fall, reign Bibles, turn with me to the book of Psalms, and we're going to go with Psalms 22. I know you're probably always thinking Psalms 23, but we'll go to Psalms 22. Amen. Psalms 22. Sometimes I've been wanting to go a little longer. Anybody else? Anybody else feel like I've been? Yeah. They've been looking at me. Like, okay, come on. This is like their tackling. So they're telling you, come on. I'm like, what you say? What you say? I'm worship. My mind's in worship. You know? And he said, well, you need help. Yeah, help, I need them to go on the longer. Glory to God. I don't know about you, God is good.
Yes, yes.
He's worthy to be praised. Amen?
Amen.
And now, can I be real? I don't know if some of you really talk to me. I talk. And I listen to what God has to say, but I also hear us. And they've been telling me for years. People have been telling me for years, we're not supposed to tell God stuff. Not supposed to complain. You heard that before. Glory to God. Maybe you just want to roll your sleeve up, because when you look at the word, you find out somebody that was lying. Excuse me, somebody. Mother, I didn't say that. I said somebody's been not telling the truth. Glory to God. You know, mother don't like certain words with us. So she in the house, I know what not to say. You know, glory to God. So it's amazing to me when I go to the Word of God and have been even taught certain things and hearing things, only to see the Word shows me something different. Ultimately, let me say that this sheet. Father has been doing this thing lately where we've been doing this prophetic thing. Now, let me tell you about prophetic. Anybody here walk in the prophetic? Glory to God. Then you need to know the prophets go first. Somebody say prophet. Yeah, yeah. Brother Jack didn't even say it. I said the prophets go first. In Jesus. Y'all kind of remind me, they used to be a cartoon called the Hillbilly Bears. And Papa Bear, every time he talked, he didn't know what he said. I'm going to go. I'm going to go. I'm going to go. I'm going to ball. You only catch the last bird. Y'all sounded like that. Like, you know, ask something. Glory to God. But listen, I want you to listen for a moment, if you will, to understand God is doing something. From a prophetic standpoint, prophets go first. Let me do it like this. You know, let's say it like this. If you wanted to be strategic, let's be strategic for a second. And let's imagine that we were going on a military, you know, a military type thing. Who's going first? It would be the apostle and the prophet. They're going to be forerunners. The apostle will be the forerunner. The prophet, they're going together. Prophetically, in a shape, because we're going to do it this way, and you say from that standpoint of just going on a journey, and you talk about from an army standpoint, let's say it like this. Who's going to engage the enemy first? Who's going to engage the enemy first? Going to be the apostle and the prophet. Hence, if I'm in the infantry, and there's somebody else, another one's going to be point man, let them go, because if they're going to step on if someone's supposed to, if they got a landmine, somebody's supposed to go and find out where we're supposed to step. Brother Jack, I don't want to volunteer you. You know what I'm saying? You don't, anybody in the house? Prophetically, prophets get to go first in many things. And so what the world is experiencing, the prophet gets to go and experience. I'm not in the house, man.
Come on. Yes, we are.
The prophets get to experience it first. And then the church goes through. And it's like after the prophet has already gone through. Does that make sense? Glory to God. The bomb, in other words, they had to deal with what you're going to deal with. So what happens is like this. The church is usually in this mode. The church is crying, and the prophets over there laughing. So the prophet looked like they kind of, because they went through what you're going through, now they're on the other side. Y'all not hearing me. Prophetically, when the prophet is walking in that office, when they start to do certain things, they do it by demonstration. Glory to God. So they do it by demonstration. So just a minute, what happens is the prophet has us doing some crazy stuff. The prophet will speak and say, listen, God said, pull it out the air. And you're looking like, pull what out? Take three steps, turn around. You're like, that don't make sense. Well, we'll take three steps and turn around for what? I'm going to stand right here. But it deals with a sense of demonstration. And so you have to understand. You say, what did all it got to do? Because you over here, you said, go to Psalms 22. Part of Psalms 22 is prophetic. It's a song. It's sang in a certain, with a certain tune. And so it's prophetic in nature. Part of it is us being able to see David go through, and let's call David going through in the sense of David just being his own personal stuff. But prophetically, we get to see Jesus on somebody. We get to see Jesus going through for humanity. And so you have to be able to get certain things, to get in tune with it, but you can relate, you'll be able to relate with certain things. I'm only going to do about two or three verses. One verse, third verse, and specifically because it's where everybody's at. And what the Holy Spirit has been showing me, I mean, you've been crying. Anybody? Just want to get to the other side? Want to get through? Well, prophetically, there's some things that God has been showing me. I'm like, man, why are we here? Why are we experiencing certain things? It is necessary because of what God's going to take us. You can rather, if you like, to sit right there and stay where you're at. Glory to God. It's kind of like this. Anybody like those rides at the amusement park? Like the roller coasters? Where you get to go like this? The only time I want to do it is when it stops. But imagine getting on a roller coaster that never goes anywhere. That's where some of you are at right now. You're not going where God wants you to go. It's a journey in the midst of it. There will be some ups, some downs, some twists and turns. Maybe some things that you're not going to want to have to endure. And some of you are excited. Just, you know, when it starts, people get excited. Just creeping up. Dante, you know, Minister Dante, just creeping up. Some folks get excited. They start raising their hand. I'm thinking, don't you understand what you're getting ready to embark on? You can get hurt. We just said this is fun. A thrill. Glory to God. Get to the top. Looking down. There's some things we need to understand. We get ready to embark in. We're going to encounter. And what I need you to understand, what you're going to see. this psalmist began to write some things, and as he writes, he's writing about some stuff he's going through. But when we get to verse 3, man, there's so much here. And I'm only going to do 3 verses in this. You don't have to worry about it all day long. I'm not going to be here all day. He's going to tell you some things. Somebody tells you, won't tell you something. Even if you don't want to listen. The psalmist, first of all, I want you to get this. Because of his covenant relationship. Because of his covenant relationship, he's able to talk to God. Come on, somebody. Anybody ever understand my question? The authorities? And somehow you want to tell them. You ever ride with somebody that don't know when to stop? And they want to tell, let them know, I know my rights. You ever go with somebody like that? You just want to tell them, just be still. You just going to take this ticket. Let's get out. You know? But and so they want to let them know, I know my rights. You watch these videos, and folks know their rights, they go to jail. Still know their rights. You don't have a right to do that. You can't ask me for that. You can't have my license. You can't have my ID. Right? Well, one of the things that the psalmist in his writing, if you're attentive, and this is what beats us up, is that we don't know our covenant agreement. And so because we don't know our covenant agreement, we get beat by the enemy. We feel like God's not on our side. He's not for us. Come on, somebody. We keep asking God, where did you go? Why did you leave me? God, do you not hear me? Nobody? Yeah. Say, you want to remind God how bad you hurt. But at the same time, if you know your covenant relationship, there's some things that you should already know. And if you watch what happens, then let me do this when we go on side of prayer, because y'all looking at me like y'all want me to be cool before I get started. In Psalms 22, and let's do, I'm going to do it from the King James. I started to read from another translation. I'm going to do it from King James. That way we'll be on the same page.
I get the air.
Oh, yeah. I have
so wild with all the answers.
Oh, okay. Because you turned it towards me because I was going to pass out. Yeah, I feel like I'm going to have to do something that I learned when I was younger. Keisha, I didn't know his mother get on my case because I tried to help mother so many times. She had an accident once. And I thought, hey, there's a chance for them to get rich. And Apostle, I just yelled out, oh, like I was really hurt. I was saying, you don't shut up. And I'm thinking, I'm trying to get you money. Anyway, I was thinking if they don't give me air, I'm just going to fall down, lay down like I passed out. Psalms 22. And most of you, after reading, you're going to find out if you have a good Bible. I shouldn't say that because you might just have a Bible. But there are some Bibles that have a little bit. What happens is that there is something that's before I start reading. And it's really an introduction in terms of giving you some insight in terms of this because it's letting you tell, like I told you before, how you're told this is prophetic, but it's also a song. And in the song, it is sung to a certain tune. It also lets you know that how we're supposed to go and meet God early in the morning. Somebody early in the morning. Glory to God. The first thing we're supposed to be, is what Psalms is putting out for us, is that this God that we serve, who he is. He starts to talk about who he is. But we get right here and we say, someone say, my God.
My God.
My God. When you see this word in this context that you understand, when you see my God in this context, really what it means is not just saying my God, but my Father. He said, my Father. Because what he's done is like, here is, you ever been in this place? Anybody ever been in this place where you're crying and you can come to the point, you just cry so that you say, I wept like a little kid. Well, we say, I cried like a little kid. I cried like a baby. Anybody? Yep. Someone told you, you cried like a baby. Well, basically what's happened in that context is that you became to a place that you were so vulnerable that you spent yourself, and it didn't matter because you came into a place that you humbled yourself. You became like a child. You know, kid cries and it doesn't take much. Glory to God. Kids cry because they're hungry. Well, adults do that too, but kids cry because you took away their toy. Kids cry. You know what I'm saying? But when we get to this place, the psalmist, in this case, we're talking about David. David's crying out. He's saying, Daddy, like, you know, this is where it's like, Father, my Father. And it becomes, you know, there are some things that goes, how you say, it's national. It's meant that there is a word for the whole of Israel where everybody's included, but there's also the place where it's personal. And what the psalmist was doing, what David is doing to us is that he's making it personal, and he says, my Father. You ain't ever been to that place? See, because it's his prayer. It's his situation, and he says, my God, or my Father, and then he asks the question, why? You ever did this? Why have you forsaken? And see again, what I'm saying to us is that we've been taught we're not supposed to say certain things, that we can't ask God certain things. And if you watch all through the Word, they keep asking God. Did he say why? Why has... But understanding your covenant relationship, in your covenant relationship, I can tell you this. God will never leave you nor forsake you. He says that. And so if you are a child of the King, I don't care what's going on, what you're experiencing, where you're at right now, or what you're going. Come on, somebody. We go through some very difficult times, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. We go through some places that nobody else will understand. They don't know how it is. They don't know the depths of it. They don't understand the substance in it. They don't understand what you're going through because it's my personal situation. And so David's talking from a place where he's hurting, and he's crying out because he feels like he is all alone. Has anybody ever been there? Where it feels like God has forsaken you. God has forgotten you. God has forgotten your name. Help me, Holy Ghost. See, why it's prophetic is because you remember when Jesus was on the cross? Jesus was on the cross for you and I. And Jesus was in a place where he needed to hear from his Father.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Woo. Jesus was like, my daddy, my father. He's forsaken me. He's left me all alone. That, in that context, Jesus was alone because the Father wasn't speaking. Sometimes when the Father doesn't speak to you right away. I guess this is for nobody. Nobody else. Nobody else. Nobody else. And so not only do I relate with David and I see Christ, but I can understand, Brother Darrell, what it's like sometimes when I go into some places that nobody else. You ever get someone say, I'm praying for you? Glory to God. Someone, you ever had someone tell you, I'm with you? No, I need you to be here with me. Come on, y'all, old brother. Someone telling you, I'm there in the spirit. No, I don't need you in the spirit. I need you in the natural. And he says, my Father, why hast thou forsaken me? Why are you far from helping me? And from the words, you know what it's like when no one's around and all that stuff in your head just seems like it's so loud. Yes, yes. Woo, help me, Holy Ghost. The devil beat us up sometimes. It's all inside. It's in your head. You're getting beat. And I don't care what else is going on around. Just the noise in your head sometimes is louder.
Yes, it is.
Woo! Enemy will torment you.
Yes.
He keep reminding you. Come on, anybody trying to sleep? And it's not the faucet's drip, but the drip of the noise presented by the tormenting spirit that keeps reminding you, your God's in it. But look at you. Look what's going on in your life. And you're wondering whether or not, and you've been crying out to God, yet to no avail. It's personal, right? It's personal. And sometimes you like for everything to be for everybody, but that's not the case. He says, oh my God, I cry in the day. Anybody crying out in the daytime? Somebody was telling me something. I don't understand this, but I experienced it in the hospital during the day. I ain't going to tell you I was all right, but you know, during the day I was hurting, but it seemed like in the midnight hour, it was worse. Anybody been there? Yeah. Seemed like you were sick, but it seemed like you get sicker when the night comes on. Whatever was hurting, it seemed like it hurt more when it get dark. Woo! You know, I'm just going to say this. You know, if you've ever been in a place where you've been down and you needed somebody else to help you, and you were dependent on somebody else, not only do you hurt more, but the people seem more agitated when they come. He says, oh my God, I cry in the daytime and you hear us not. Anybody been there? It's prophetic, but this is reminiscent of the body of Christ right now. For many of you, you've been called to intercede. You've been called to intercede on behalf of some others that are going through some places and you don't understand it. It's like, man, this is tough, this is hard. I need somebody to be praying for me. But if you're the intercessor, if you're called to intercede, this is not in here, I'm just throwing that to you. If you're called to intercede, you need to be praying, because if you pray for their breakthrough, somebody else is over there praying for yours. And I say this because, you know, we got too many folks that keep quitting. They keep quitting in the midst of the job. They upset because they tired, and you've been working longer. You've been having overtime. Jesus, you on your third overtime, so you going into a whole other day. And they got an hour overtime and they upset. Some of them just 4 hours into their shift and they tired. It's too much work. Glory to God. I'm going to make it mad, but you know, I listened. My granddaughter was sharing with me about her job, and I'm thinking, glory to God, you're making more than I'm making, $20 an hour. And all you got to do is take your order. You ought to be a manager. Don't tell her I said that. I'm like, man, we upset. But I'm going to tell you this. If you're called to pray, don't stop praying. Let's hurry up. Let's hurry up. So he says, my God, remember, oh my God, oh my Father, I cry in the daytime. You don't hear me. And in the night season, man, see, night is like a season because it takes so long. Yes. At night, it seems longer than it does at day. Yes. I'm in the right house. And you're silent. See, God is still, I still haven't heard from God. You've been praying and God hasn't answered. What I love, let me tell you this, what I love, because I have to go sometimes prophetically, I have to step in places. And sometimes you need to know this. You're going through some places right now. Some of the places that you're going through, it has nothing to do with you. Amen. What you're experiencing is because what God is about to do for the body. Mess you up. You know, tap that apostle over there and say, this is for you. Tap the apostle right there and say, this is for you. See, prophetically, you recognize some folks. Right off the bat, this is stuff you need to hear. Consequently, you're going through, and it's not just, you know, because we feel like, Brother Jack, feel like, man, I done had enough. Anybody feel like you done had enough? Nobody, glory to God. Sister Linda, just you and I, like, touch and agree. Glory to God. Brother Darrell, you look like one of the person that just said, just one more. Give me one more. I can handle it. Come on, I want to talk to somebody that's been going through. Anybody here been going through? Glory to God. So it's good to know that somebody's praying, right?
Amen.
But it's hard when you're praying and you don't see answers. You don't hear the answer. You don't see God moving. It's difficult sometimes for us. Now, can I just be real? I'm talking to you. I hope I make sense. Some of us want to quit when we pray. Come on now. When we pray and we don't get an answer right away. God, you took a little long. Come on, Mama. Can we real?
Yeah.
You don't love. Just going back to your covenant agreement. You all agree with me on this. On your covenant agreement, God never lies, right?
Right.
He cannot lie, right? You agree with that?
Right.
You agree he's all knowing?
Yes.
He's ever present?
Yes.
He has all power?
Yes.
Everybody agree with that?
Yes.
Just go like this. So if God's taking his time, you know more than God, it's okay for you to tell God, hurry up. I'm going to need you to move. Come on, in the middle of your prayer, have you ever said, God, you ever heard the prayer that said, Lord, I'm going to need you to move right now, Lord, right now. Come on, Lord. Holy. Anybody see that? I'm going to need you to move. Father,
Hey, Lord.
Anyway, right. See somebody else right now. Let me stop before I get in trouble. Listen, so here it is. You ever been in that place where you know, it's like, God, I know what's going to happen if you don't come through by this time, so I'm going to need you to click in. Oh, I just said it like, you know, as I, you know, y'all wouldn't say it like, y'all act like, oh no, I would never say it like, but you're still doing it. God, you move. God, you're moving too slow. I will need you to pick it up. Pick up the pace. You ain't never had to wait on anybody?
Yes.
And you call them up and say, when you coming? How long is it going to be? Well, anyway, he says, God, I've been praying night and day, and you still remain silent.
Wow.
So I'm calling out, but do you hear me? Because obviously, if you heard me, you would have answered. But here's what happens. Here's what happens. And here's also where you ever heard the scripture. This is partly where we get this from. There's some other scriptures as well. But God inhabits the praises
of his people.
Well, you heard it before.
Yes.
Anybody heard it before? What happens is that David starts in one place, almost sounds like he's complaining. But he's hurting. Anybody hurt? See, I hate them Christians that pretend like, you know, they don't hurt, they don't go through things, like everything's okay with them. Come on, y'all. I like to be real about stuff. If you shoot me in the toe, you drop something on my toe, that hurt. Oh, glory. Help me, Holy Ghost. I just got to be honest. You know, Bishop, I was taking... unscrewing something just yesterday and had on some of them, you know, the open-toed shoes. I knew when I did it, I said, you know, this thing, you know, you look at it something, you're thinking, I know this is going to fall. Brother Jack, once I get the screw all the way out, it's going to fall. And so I'm checking to make sure my foot is out of the way. But I readjusted my foot and put it right underneath. One thing came down on my foot. Glory! That pain went up inside of me. Come on, anybody know what?
Yeah.
I'm so glad I was a Christian, because they don't tell me what I would have said if I wasn't a Christian. Sweet Jesus. Hallelujah. Man, it hurt. So here's a guy that's hurting, and he's going through something because he's hurting his personal sense. But here's what's getting ready to happen. And as I was telling you, I said, the scripture that you're familiar with, that, how you say, God inhabits
the praise of his people.
God inhabits the praises of his people. What you get is, it's almost going to turn this around where you can really see it. I'm going to stop in this because there's so much more I want to give, but I don't have time to do this. There's something you need to understand. Because what happened is, he's in the midst of sharing with God about what's going on, this personal stuff that's happening to him. But then he has to look at the fact that who he's talking to and the power, the sovereignty. Come on, y'all gotta understand. Sometimes when you're praying, you need to recognize the God that you're talking to. Yes. Our Father.
Yes, yes, yes.
Who art in heaven.
Yes.
How sacred is thy name. Come on, we gotta get to the place where we start to recognize who God is.
Yes.
It will change my position and my posture.
Yeah.
When I begin to understand that my God is able to make a way out of no way.
Yes. Hallelujah.
One of the things that has to happen is that we got to recognize that who God is. And so what he does when he says, he was saying he throws, or he inhabits this place. It's kind of like what he was saying to us. It's kind of like you have to go back and go into that place, even where you were able to go into the throne
room.
And in the midst of the throne room, you would suddenly see even the angels as they come forth and saying, holy, holy, holy. Because they recognize the presence of an almighty God. They see they're in awe of this God and what he's able to do. Somehow or another. Somehow or another. We enter into prayer not knowing who we're talking to. Come on, somebody. It's one thing to talk to one of your buddies. What you call him, your homie. It's one thing to have one of your homies that you're talking to that hollers, I got your back. But then when you really need them, man, I just need $20. Man, I ain't got that. I would if I had it, but just spent my last. But this God that we're talking about, evangelist Washington, this God is able to do the impossible.
Amen.
So what he's saying to us, he said, but thou art holy, the one that inhabits the praises of Israel. But he was making it personal, national, and personal, because what he was saying, when he says this, he does three things. I make a point. He recognizes, as I said, the sovereignty of God, that he sits on the throne, that no matter what I'm going through, my circumstances and situation, he is still in control of it all.
Amen.
Man, man, man. I don't care how much you want to whine and cry. Come on. I don't care how much you complain. He's not here. I don't feel like he's here. He's able to do what none other can. He can make a way when there is none. He can make a way out of nowhere. So Psalmist comes, and immediately he recognizes the sovereignty of God. This God that sits on the throne, that recognizes, if you will, he's in authority. Come on, somebody. What do you mean about this authority? This is the same God that can speak and cause the winds to go in a different direction. This is the God that can cause the day to stop or the sun to stop and stand still and or cause the sun to go back.
Come on, that's who he is. Come on.
Wait. This is a God. Otherwise, say, God, we only had just a little bit more daylight. It's done.
Come on.
This is the God that says, listen, if you just get into the water, at a certain time, I'm going to have an angel trouble the water, and all you got to do is be the first gift.
Come on.
You know what gets crazy is because he'll do things like he said, you didn't make it today, and it's supposed to happen next year, but today is your day. You got to recognize, see, this is the God. Anybody going through something financially? This is the God that says, hey, listen, we don't have the money for the tax, but what I want you to do, you a fisherman.
Yes.
You've been used to fishing, but I know how you think in terms of your fishing. And so I want to tell you how I want to do something that I might be glorified even in this.
Come on, somebody. Come on.
Since I'm a fisherman, I know how to fish. Come on, y'all know what I'm talking about. Because you like to do it yourself. You like to make a way to make it happen. And God says, you're not going to make this happen. Because I'm God, and I'm going to do what you can't do. I want you to know that I want the glory for what I'm about to do. So get ready to move everything out of the way to cause you to be where I want you to go. No, sister, that we don't have the money. Look like everything's gonna crash. God said, listen, to the fisher, go down and the first fish. See, it would have been something. He said, just keep fishing until you find one. But he said, the first fish that you catch. Reach in his mouth. Come on, somebody. You got to understand. It's prophetic. Amen. That God gives him a prophetic word. And demonstration in the midst of the prophetic. Reach into the mouth of the... Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Ain't no way I want to be sticking my hands into the fish's mouth. Come on. I must be in the wrong house. Glory to God. I hear you, Apostle Darrell. It's like... I don't know about anybody else. I'm not afraid of a fish.
Amen.
But now I'm like, Jesus, don't you want me to cut his head off? And then by chance, as I look in.
Where are the gloves?
Jesus said, reach into the fish's mouth. Woo! Tell somebody, God, see, in his sovereignty, that means he can do what he wants, how he wants, when he wants.
Come on, wherever.
This is how he wants it. This is one of the things that's happening, is that the psalmist, David, is recognizing who my God is. And even though he has not answered, he can answer when he's ready to answer. What he wants to do, he will do it according to. If I can just get somebody to say, like the Hebrew boys, even if he doesn't, I know he can. It don't always go the way you want it to. See, they keep talking to us. Even when we're hard-headed, I'm going to turn around with this. Because nobody here is hard-headed. Nobody here is stubborn. Ooh. Help me, Holy Ghost. Wave your hand at your neighbor and say, I know that one's for you. Glory to God. Glory to God. Look at your neighbor and say, this one. Brother Jack, don't do it because she might get you. Listen. Look at your neighbor. Say, that's a word for you. She's thinking it. You know what I'm saying? Glory all around you. There's people. Look at that, Sister D. They didn't hesitate. They just pointed right at you. That's all. Every week, they must call Sister D. Look at this. Here's a place, even when we're stubborn, I said we, right?
Yeah.
Even when we're stubborn.
Amen.
You know, that it's kind of like this. You know, I always wanted to be a choir director. The only part I wanted to do was get them up. I want to do something really just outrageous. I don't want to just go like, if I'm going to do it, Brother Jack, I'm going to put everything into it. Listen, even though you're stubborn, God still hears. He still moves. He still sees. You got me, Rosie? Sometimes it's not our stubbornness, it's just our fear. Just our fear. Sometimes our fear hinders us from moving in the direction that God intends. I'm trying to hurry. Hear something, everybody? Ooh. Hey. Psalmist recognizes when he says he inhabits the praises. He had to recognize the sovereignty of God, the authority of God. The authority of God says that God is able to control my situation. God is able to change my circumstances. God is able to move in my situation. Even though I haven't heard, he hasn't spoke. Tell somebody God still hears. God still hears. Even though I'm afraid, God still sees, still knows. Whew. And God is yet moving. Then I seen something, even in that moment. I won't tell you this like this, I'd be crazy for a second. But I see you praying. You say, God, we really need a miracle in this area. And had to do some finances. We need to see this amount come through. I'd like to see this. God says, what you're asking for, he said, to tell you again, is already done. He says, it's done. I'm not just talking. He says, if you'll hear it. So you'll see this amount. It looks like maybe your enrollment is down or something's not going like you want. But God said, as you pray, he says, even now, he says, tell you it's already done. You ever won't change? But look like nothing happened? Look like everything's falling down? Anybody? Anybody been there? Woo! And God said, tell him. He said, now's not the time for you to be giving up. He said, you got to remember who's on the firm. Hey, God Almighty. So the psalmist, as he's praying, and he's saying, this is the God that we pray. This is what all Israel recognizes, that he's the true king.
Amen.
His sovereignty and his authority always reigns. See, they can understand kingship. We can't. We get lost with some of things like that. Brother Denton, I tell you, we don't understand it. But they can understand when they're talking about God, and it's lost for us sometimes in the midst of our culture. It's lost for us when we say he inhabits the praises of his people. His praying people will praise him because of his goodness. They'll praise him because of his grace. They praise him because of his generosity. They praise him because he is a king that understands the need of his people. Yeah. Yeah. It's kind of like you see Jesus. Jesus being the one that intercedes for us and understands what we're going through. Come on, somebody. He stands in that place for each of us. And so here's what's happening. As that he understands who he's looking at. He understands the God that's overseeing, even though he was complaining. It's like I had to stop and pause. Tell somebody we need to put our murmuring and complaining on pause just for a minute. Amen. See, because sometimes in the midst of all that, in the midst of your complaining and your murmuring and going forth, sometimes you got to put everything, just put it on pause. Just kind of hit the brakes. You ever hit the brakes suddenly? Yes. Woo! Every now and then I do what's called a brake check. Well, let me call it a safety check or a seatbelt check. I just want to make sure if you haven't put your seatbelt on, that you understand there could be a collision at any moment. My wife has come to understand that this happens on certain occasions, and said, so I let her know, you need to put your belt on. And after you've moved a couple of times real close to almost, you don't have to put your arm out. Come on, somebody. We don't have to do it that many times. Listen, some of us need to take just one moment and do a safety check. Spiritual safety check. You recognize who God is. In it, what's going to happen? Does anybody know the God that you serve is able?
Yes.
Does anybody believe that what you're going through, your situation, is not too big for God? Amen. So you got to remind yourself that he's the God of all flesh. Tell somebody that includes you. And nothing is too hard for the Lord. Listen, I got to hurry up, guys. I got to hurry up. Am I making sense to anybody?
Yeah.
But when he says that he inhabits the praise of his people, the other thing is that you got to understand that one of the things that comes forth is that God said in this place of praise, this is why I had to look at something that I hadn't seen in before or hadn't been thinking about. Let me say it like that. I know it, but I hadn't thought about it in a while. And this morning, then you think about Pastor Vicky. I thought of Pastor Vicky because if you remember the name of her ministry, anybody? Epineo. Epineo comes from another word. There are a number of words that talk about or bring forth praise. And epineo is another word that has to do with praise. And God was saying when we inhabit or he inhabits the praise of his people, part of that is because understanding that God is ruling and reigning, that he is the king, that you've got to understand we are his subjects, we are his people, we are his possession. Amen. Whew. Y'all miss this. Y'all miss this. You're going to miss this. You're going to miss this. There's one thing that has to happen. Remember I told you, one of the things that happens is that this guy understands his covenant. He understands his rights. And because he understands his covenant rights, he knows what he can say and what he's to look for from God. Amen. I'm going to quit on you. I'm going to quit on you. Glory to God. Most of us are in a place where we're walking in a place of lack. You ever heard this expression, an open heaven? Anybody? And almost to the point where we think is something that's supposed to happen every now and then. And the only sense of us really getting an idea of an open heaven is when we talk about Jacob's ladder. I saw the angels ascending and descending. Anybody? Well, he said, while the prayer was yet going up, it ain't the first time it happened. King Hezekiah was on his bed when he got a word. And the word for Hezekiah was simply this: get your affairs in order, because this sickness is as unto death. You remember that? What'd he do? I heard somebody say he turned his face to the wall. All he did was turn away from everybody else. He had to. You ever get to this place where you really want to get with God and you say, listen, I got to push everything else. I got to close everything off. I got to get away from everybody else, because me and God got to get in this place. It just has to be me and God. And what he did when he took, see, because you understand, the king constantly has servants all around him. He had to turn his face to the wall, even in the midst of a sickness, because I got to block all y'all. I don't want one of you coming to help me. You can't do nothing about this now. You can't move in this place. Where you at right now, can't nobody move for you. Can't nobody do this but God. Can't nobody answer me but God. He says like this. And Hezekiah turned his face to the wall. But remember, the prophet that gave him the word was strutting. He was walking on his way out. Okay. Bishop said, get back. So here's the prophet on his way out. He does not even get out of the courtyard. And the father said, he told Hezekiah, I've heard your cry. Yes. I've seen your tears. And I'm answering you. He says, I'm adding to your years. But he told the prophet, go back and tell him. The prophet ain't in God's courtyard. Go back. Prayer's still going up. Answer coming down.
Yeah.
Tell somebody, open heaven. If it happened then, it should be happening now. If we understand some things in our covenant relationship, it's like, wait a minute, Father. Listen. Do you remember when Daniel was praying? The only thing that happened with Daniel's prayer is that the enemies decided to come in and say, we're going to stop this. I need you to hear this. I'm very close. Seriously. I was in this place. I was praying. And as I prayed, I talked to the Father. And I told Daddy, you know what I mean? Anybody ever cry?
Yes.
Not your sister did, but...
No.
No, you'll cry. You're tough. You're too tough. Anybody ever cry?
Yes. Yes.
Hard.
Yes.
You'll cry?
Oh, no.
You know, Sister Barton, I can tell some of y'all ain't crying because y'all, you know, because somebody told me before, don't make me cry. This is not, I don't want to mess up with mascara. You ain't crying. You ain't cried till your mascara's messed up.
No.
Tell me, hold it up. But when you cry, when you really cry, woo! Brian told me the other day, she said, now listen, don't do anything in the wedding to make me cry, because this face, put a whole lot into it. You should be happy. They gonna love you anyway. He need to see all that. Some of you haven't really cried. Because when you really cry, you're going to have to. You're not going to look good crying. When you really cry. Leave that woman alone, man. Listen, watch it. Here you cry. I was crying out to God. Yet, I'm going to be real, Brother Jack. Sometimes in our crying, men have a tendency, sometimes we don't want to show our tears. And so we fight the tears. Anybody fight your tears? Anybody fight your tears? Glory to God, look at them. Brother Jack, you ever fight your tears? Yeah, you see, what do you think? Good, good, good. Oh, I ain't the only one. Glory to God. You fight your tears. Shoot. Glory to God. I fight him and then leave it to Bieber or something. Come on, he just start crying. I don't know. But listen, men had a tendency to have their eyes swept. Ladies, you just do. Y'all can just cry. You can cry because the leaves are falling. Oh, Lord, the leaves fall. You just cry. And help me. And so men, their eyes tend to sweat. You know. You say, what is that? Oh, that wind blew that sand. I didn't feel the wind, but the sand, it got in my eye.
Depends on where I am.
Glory to God. I understand that one. I understand that. Right, so that's what you can just let it go. But listen, I was crying out to God. And I was trying to be, I don't know if I was being macho or just kidding.
That's macho.
Just kidding. What did you say?
That's macho.
Just kidding. I'm just being kidding. And what happened, I was telling God, like the psalmist, I was telling God. I said, Father, I know you hear, but I told him, I know you hear me. Mm-hmm. Not like, I know you hear me, but it was like, I know you hear me.
Amen. Amen.
I stayed, because I know my covenant, I still stayed.
Amen.
He told you to come boldly to the throne of grace in your time.
Amen.
That
you may.
Hallelujah.
So we're going to be able to come in these places, yeah. And we've been told we have to come a certain way and be hesitant. I talk to Daddy. I said, Daddy, see my father, Abba. And I talked to him. I talked to Yahweh. The everlasting. Anyway, when I spoke, I was telling him as to what is going on. Not that he did not know, because of our covenant relationship, he talks to me in the midst of things, and he lets me know things that are going to happen before they. Because when you get to be friends with God, he starts to share with you things that are going to happen before. Some of y'all not getting it because y'all not friends. So he's telling me some things. But yet I'm crying. Because I'm, you ever get tired? Weary would be a better word for us. And you can't quit. Tell somebody, you can't quit.
Can't quit.
Sister, then tell somebody you can't quit.
Can't quit, sister.
We feel like it sometimes, but you don't get to
right.
quit.
That's not an option.
Anybody else feel like, you just feel like you want to quit, right. But you can't quit.
Right.
Where shall we go?
Quitting yeah. is not an option.
Amen.
Brother from there, I preached that message one time, and glory to God, I didn't know it was going to come back to haunt me so many times. My son would tell me all the time, said, Dad, look what you said, quitting was not an option. I got some things, just trying to get something off with me. I said, I'm through with this. He said, Dad, quitting. I'm going to hit it again. But listen, as I was crying to God, and I just came to the point, I said, okay, Father, send your hands. I told him everything. I said, I'm going to trust you. I said, but at the same time, the enemy's tormenting. Anybody been tormenting? The enemy trying to tell you. The enemy will try to tell you the promises that God's made, and yet the promises that have been in your life that have not come to fruition. He starts to show you things. Anybody? And literally what happens is you start, it's like a puzzle. Your whole life becomes a puzzle. And all the pieces just, even though you had them on the board, seem like everything now is down, it's all scattered. It looked like whatever was happening was destroyed. All these pieces of your life. And you're wondering even to the point, God, what is the point? Anybody?
Yeah.
But yet at the same time, you say, God, in the midst of all this, I know you here, so even if it don't come together, I'm just going to trust you.
Amen.
You have your own Job moment, though you slay me, yet will I
praise you.
So live. Say, okay, Father, whatever you want, I'm just going to go on. I'll just go on. And I'm riding on. I just said, well, you know what? I feel like I'm by, you ever feel like you're by yourself? Nobody knows. You ever been there?
Yeah.
See, I've even had it since. I got a few people in my, what you call it now, your contacts. You used to have a Rolodex. Now it's a contact list. And I have a few people in my contacts list. But in my contact list, even brother, how you say this, Brother Jack, there are some people that they rolled over to be my favorites. You got some favorites? I'm not ready to just take all my favorites and just put everybody in the contact list. Glory to God. Mother, I'm going to keep you in my contact list. Look at that. See that? Y'all don't get that. That's me and Mother. That, in case you don't understand that, Brother Darrell, what that means, Mother always say, where's my daughter? I said, Mother, behold thy son. I won't be seen. So Mother's on. So listen, and so literally, as I was crying out to God, this is important for you, because I didn't understand God was dealing with me even prophetically, because many of you are going through. And so what I'm dealing with, has some of it has nothing to do with me, but has everything to do with you.
My Lord.
And I was crying to God, but yet now I say, okay, Father, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Just give me the strength to walk through these places.
Amen.
Discouraged. Don't have the same pep, but you're walking. I'm talking to anybody yet?
Yes.
I talked to this man of God. And we was talking. I called him by mistake, because I called him and I realized, you know, he had something else going on that day. And then he told me, no, I don't have it going on. And we were just talking. And in the midst of the conversation, he said, wait a minute, stop. It almost scared me, because I'm driving down the street. He just said, stop. And I'm like, in the middle of the traffic. He said, stop. God said, that gets your attention right there, God said.
Right.
He said, God said, and he began to tell me what was going on between me and God. So I said, uh-oh. He was listening to the Father. And the Father began to speak to me about the things I was talking to him about. And what he was telling me, he said, trust me. Tell somebody, trust me.
Trust me.
I have been in that place where you're going through, and God said that we're getting ready to come out in the midst of this thing. No matter what it looks like, God said, we're coming through. Tell somebody it's not what you think it is. Amen. It's not what you think it is. Tell somebody, God says, I'm turning this around. Wait, come on, somebody. Prophetically, tell somebody we have come to the end.
We have come to the end.
You've come to the end, and it looks like now I got to turn around and go back. God said, no, I'm getting ready to make a way at the end of this place. Right here, this is where we're getting ready to put a memorial stone up. Because right here, I'm getting ready to make a way out of no way. So right in this place, I'm getting ready to raise some things up. Right in this spot. Ooh. Come on, somebody. Stand up where you at. Tell somebody I'm coming out. Tell somebody God's getting ready to make a way.
God's getting ready to make a way.
Listen, the next time you say,
that God inhabits the praises of his people. Understand that where God is at in the midst of your situation. Understand that God is standing in the midst of your circumstance, in the midst of your situation. Can I tell you, in the midst of your pain, God is right there. God can speak to your pain and say, tell the pain to stop. Help me, Holy Ghost. Help me, Holy Ghost. Tell somebody God's getting ready to do something that has never been done before. God's getting ready to do something for you that no one else could do. God's getting ready to do for you like nothing else would ever matter.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God.
Somebody in the house want to give God praise. I want to tell you something. In spite of what it looks like, God said, yet there is more that I have in store. God said, before you leave, he says, I'm going to give you joy like you've never had before. Tell somebody, God said, joy, unspeakable joy. God said, I'm getting ready to give you something that you've never experienced, that you've never had. God said, I'm getting ready to walk you through some places. You know, you look at some things, even to this end, where it looks like the walls are closing in. God said, I'm not finished in the midst of this thing. It's some things in the midst of our families that God said, I'm getting ready to cause those things to come together, where it looks like everything is broken up and broken down and all the pieces have been shattered. He said, I'm going to put it back together.
Amen.
And it'll look like it did when it was first. Somebody. Woo! Listen, tell somebody. There's been some years that have been stolen. God says, I'm the redeemer of time. See, this is what you got to understand. He says, I'm getting ready to redeem the time, the seasons and the years. Those things that have been stolen, I'm getting ready to give them back to you. Woo! But understand, God is not finished with you yet. There is yet more. I'm trying to stop right. I'm just trying to be finished with this. Didn't mean to be up here so long. God wants you to know. Listen, can I say it like this? Can I talk to you personally? Can I talk to you? It's been rough. The last 6 years been an upward climb, emotional upheaval. I know some of your personal struggles, but yet at the same time, I want you to understand, there's been more of the sense of feeling like you're by yourself. God said, I'm getting ready to return everything back to what you would call normal, but what was normal wasn't good. So he says, what I'm going to create is called normal. It's what I intended for it to be all along. He says, I'm getting ready to establish and set things in order that they might walk, and this is your family, he said that they might walk together as one.
Amen.
Yeah. We can go to church and still can't get along. Ooh. God said, I'm getting ready to do some things that no one else can do. He says, I'm getting ready collectively to do some things that no one else can do. He says, I'm getting ready to fix some things, align some things, cause some things to come together in your life that no one else can do. Have you ever felt like you were handicapped, felt like you were lacking, felt like you were missed, somehow felt like you were disabled because you didn't have what everybody else had? God said, I'm getting ready to give you. I'm causing you to come into this place where your cup runneth over. He said, I'm calling you into a place. Somebody say, come. My covenant with you is that I'm bringing you into the place that you can be blessed and be a blessing. Ooh. Help somebody. Tell somebody, God's getting ready to do something for you. God's getting ready to call you into a whole new place. Collectively, God's getting ready to change some things. Glory to God. I'm trying to get out of the house. Listen, let's pray. Gracious Father, I'm thanking you for yet what you're doing, how you're restoring, how you're renewing, how you're bringing us into this place. You're orchestrating something that we could never have done ourselves. I thank you for how you're bringing together, how you're causing us to begin to hold, unite, and come together as one, according to the Spirit of the living God. I thank you, Father, that you're going to give us the insight and the understanding, the foresight, even to know what's coming, and yet walk us through this thing. Whew. that you're going to be glorified in the midst. I thank you, Father, for the breakthroughs that are established in this hour. For you are the Lord of the breaking out or the breaking through. And I thank you, Father, for the breakthroughs that come forth on today. That the people of God will praise you like never before. For you inhabit the praises of your people. Father, for we are your possession. We are yours. And Father, you take care of all of us. So I thank you yet for what you're going to do. For what you're doing. And how you're going to do it. Oh, glory to God. Somebody give the Lord a praise in the house. Somebody. If there's sickness in your body, collectively, I want you to touch yourself this morning and just say, Father, I thank you for your word. For you said that by your stripes that we were healed. In Jesus' name. Listen. Y'all said it, but you got to believe it when you take hold of this. God is going to do what he said he would do. In spite of what they're saying, I want to tell you what God said. God said, I want to do this for my people if they would just hold on. If they'll just trust me, God said, I'm getting ready to do something in you that no man can ever do. Woo! Help me, Holy Ghost.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord God.
Now, you know, they don't get mad at me for doing this because, you know, there's some things they don't want you to pray for. They don't want me to pray about finances, you know, on camera. There's some folks, you know, and then they come back and tell me, say, you know, you're praying about finance, you know. I believe God. Amen. That God has the means, the wherewithal. God is able to speak to our situation and our circumstances. He can cause people to give that had not even considered giving. He can cause them to do what they weren't going to ever do. So I want to tell you right now, if you're financially suppressed, depressed, in a place of deficiency, if you will be obedient to the Spirit of God, God's getting ready to break some things open for you. Getting ready to make some way. Oh, it's prophetic. It's prophetic. It's prophetic. It's prophetic. Whew. Whew. See, brother, girl, they see you start talking about money. Everybody say, I'm trying to get some money. I ain't trying to get that. I ain't trying to get that. I just hear the Lord. He says, give. As you give, God says, I'm going to meet from the heart. I'm going to meet and exceed your expectation. This is not a begging. This is not a begging contest. It's simply where we just got to hear God. Be obedient to the Spirit of God. I don't care how and when you do it. Be obedient to the Spirit of God. He wants you to give. And as you give, you can ready to see God's in a very move. Someone said, well, is it dependent on that? God said, I just want your obedience. I'm looking for obedience. Tell you, brothers and sisters, God's looking for obedience. She says, I'm getting ready to bless my people. He getting ready to bless the people. He said, those that will obey me. Because then I know. See, you ever found that God put you in a position. All he wants is obedience. Because now what he's looking for is to see if I can trust you. Woo! Evangelist, can he trust you? See, he didn't ask me because I don't trust him. In God we trust. Amen. Listen, I hear the Father saying, if you will yet trust me and obey, he said, I'm going to bless each of you, where you're at, in this place of your own particular need, said the Spirit of the Lord. Tell somebody over and above. What you're asking or thinking. Tell your neighbor it's done. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord.
Wait. Stop right there. If you were asking for something and they just gave you something, just gave you what you were asking for, over and above what you were asking for, and you just go. God wants to praise us this morning.
Yes.
I know we've been longer than what we're supposed to, and I apologize to you.
Right.
Amen.
Right.
I pray that you will bless on today. Amen. I'm going to ask the deacon if you'll come. Amen. Deacon Davis, I'm going to ask you to take the lead if you don't mind.